Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to this edition of Disability Viewpoints. With me today is my special co-host, Joan Willshire. Joan, who's your special guest today?
I have a great guest today, Toby Pearson, Vice President of Care Providers Minnesota. We're going to talk assisted living licensure.
Sounds great. My guest today will be Jim Thayer, who is with the Spina Bifida Association, has a lot of good information coming up, and we'll see all that and more next, coming up on Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. With me today is my special guest, Jim Thayer. Jim is a name that's really synonymous with St. Paul. He's a retirement planner for the disabled. He was co-chair of the Mayor's Committee for People with Disabilities for years and years. And he was also head of the Spina Bifida Board.
Still am.
And still am. He still is in St. Paul. So now it gives me a great pleasure to introduce to you my good friend and colleague, Jim Thayer.
Hi, Mark. Glad to be here.
Welcome to the show. Welcome to the show. What is spina bifida?
Well, spina bifida, first and foremost, is a birth defect, because there are a lot of people that actually are not sure about that. You know, they tend to think it's almost like COVID-19 that you can come down with it. But no, it's a birth defect. And here's the way I'll explain it, because I had it explained to me by, I believe it was a doctor, because it was many years ago. But anyway, the word spina bifida is actually Latin, and I didn't take Latin in school. But anyway, it's Latin, and what it stands for is split or open spine.
Right.
And so the way it works is in the first part of pregnancy, the first month or two, the backbone actually grows around the spinal cord, and that's the neurotube, and it protects it. With spina bifida, it actually stops, and there's a hole. So that means the spinal cord and any nerves attached to it right at that spot are affected. And that's where the problems begin. So, and it depends on where on the backbone is that lesion, how many nerves are affected, that's spina bifida.
As time goes on, how does it start to affect people?
Because it's a birth defect, you don't know about some things right away. I mean, obviously, the one thing that everybody sees is if someone with spina bifida is out on the street waiting for a bus or something, first thing you see is a wheelchair. So you tend to think, well, there must be something wrong with the legs. And there is, because usually what happens is those nerves that are affected, some of them are the nerves to your legs, and so you have paralysis in the legs. And depending on how many nerves are affected, sometimes, my daughter who has spina bifida can actually walk around the house, but that's it. Outside of the house, she uses a wheelchair.
Right.
And then there are other people that are actually just paralyzed from the waist down. They don't walk around the house. So it's a spectrum, you know.
And she can drive, too.
She can drive, too. And like most of us that drive, we put our pedal down like this. She goes like this, so she can actually drive.
Right.
But there are also people that actually drive and just use hand controls.
Yeah.
And, you know, and the Courage Center sets you up with those sort of things.
Absolutely.
But, yeah. But one of the other effects, which is a major effect for everybody, is is bowel and bladder are also paralyzed, and so that's always a problem. There's also what they call Arnold Chiari. It's a weird name, but I believe that was the name of a doctor years ago. And that's what happens is your brain with spina bifida sits a little farther back in your skull. You don't see it, but what that does is blocks the drainage of your cranial fluid, and so you get what they call hydrocephalus. And so a lot of people with spina bifida do have hydrocephalus, and they get shunts put in, so it's a tube that actually drains it, and it's underneath the skin so you don't see it. And so those are some of the major things that are affected at spina bifida is because of those damaged nerves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then ongoing symptoms, what are the symptoms?
Well, the symptoms, you know, it's they don't really ever go away. You know, someone's always going to have, as we know right now, someone's always going to have that paralysis in the legs. Their bowel and bladder are always going to be paralyzed. They'll probably always have shunts. And those things, they just don't go away. They just take years for it to show up. And they're ongoing. You know, it'd be nice if they'd go away. That's always the goal. But it just hasn't been accomplished.
Can never give up on medical technology.
Well, we'll never give up. I don't know 50 years from now.
There you go.
You know, I don't know.
What 2022 is right around the corner.
Yeah.
What events are you...
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, it's interesting when you talk about, you know, the association, and I've always said what we are really is just a support group, and you can call it a picnic or you can call it roller skating, it doesn't matter, it's just people getting together, supporting each other under a different name, and, you know, when I look at 2022, it can be very it's very open at this point because we're just, and still kind of at the end of it, I hope. We just went through 2020 and 21, which was pandemic related, where we've canceled so many things and we've done things virtually. 2022, we're hoping to open up and then start getting back together because, you know, I know a lot of people, and just talking about the spina bifida world, they tend to feel like they're doing their social networking because they're on the computer social networking. And maybe I'm old school, but I think face-to-face works better, you know?
Yeah,
and so I'm hoping that in 2022, you know, we can get back to, you know, face-to-face picnics and maybe we even do what we've done in the past, and it's not going to happen right now. We're looking to work on that is roller skating, believe it or not.
Great.
Yeah, we had a gentleman out in St. Louis Park that owned a roller skating rink, and he'd shut it down for us, for our association.
Great.
On a Saturday afternoon. And so then all the people with spina bifida, whether it be children, even or adults in wheelchairs, and their siblings could go out on the rink in their chairs and go around. And you know, you can't do that on a regular roller skating
No.
thing. Here's our problem. The rink went out of business. He sold it. He sold the rink because the pandemic slowed him down and he was getting older.
And there went your event.
So I'd love to actually find another rink that'll do that. A lot of them just aren't going to give away their time like that, you know. Or we need to fill it with some other event. And we'll come up with something, you know. I mean, one thing we did last year, which I think is a good idea.
How about bowling?
Well, that's what I was just going to mention. We had, in early 2020, and we've done this virtually, but we did a painting where everybody had a 16 by 20 canvas, and then we had a lady that teaches painting, and they did just painted a bird or something, and it was about 20, 30 people with spina bifida getting together to do it, and it was fun. And it was in a bowling alley, and outside of that room that they gave us to paint in, we reserved a few lanes.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, that might be a good replacement for roller skating. Let's go bowling, you know? And a lot of times we have to wait until the snow's gone. It's harder to get out and about in the middle of winter. So hopefully we can do that, you know, and hopefully we can get back to our... We did a run this year to raise money, but again, the same thing is it's just people getting together as far as I'm concerned, you know.
Yeah, so, I can give you some help after the show.
Yeah, there are things we can do, and so hopefully in 2022 we'll start getting back to face-to-face.
Yeah, so how do people learn more about spina bifida?
Well, actually, there are different things you can do. We have a website, obviously, and I know that information is going to be put on here.
Okay.
How do you get to our website?
Okay.
And actually, in this day and age, I'll just say this, you can Google it. Because, you know, spina bifida, besides heart defect, is considered one of the leading birth defects.
Right.
Actually, I've heard it was the second, you know, but who knows. The second leading behind heart defects. And so you can Google it. You can go to our website. There are different groups out there that just explain the basics, no different than what I really just explained on how it works.
Yeah, and there's a local and a national chapter.
Yeah, there is a national chapter out in Washington, D.C., and we're a local on our own, doing our own darn thing. You know, we used to be connected with them, but now we do our own thing because we're all 501c3s,
yep.
And they are and we are, and we used to be associated with them, and I used to go to a lot of national conferences that they had, and now they're on their own, and they have some East Coast chapters, and a lot of the states have chapters, and you know, and they have their own. I think it's just called SBA.org, Spina Bifida Association.org is the national one. So yeah,
sounds good. Yeah. And so now let's go back in your life a little bit, if we can. My question is, okay, you've got to make these adjustments with spina bifida, but you've got two other boys, is it?
Yeah.
And how do you incorporate all that so it looks as every day as possible? And I hope I'm using the right words.
No, you're using the right words. And that is actually a difficult thing because you've got one child that needs a lot of attention.
Yeah, and you can't give her...
And you can't forget the other two. So you really have to split your time, and you've got to make sure she gets that attention and she goes to the doctor and she does all those things. But you also have to make sure these two other ones get what they need.
Get to hockey practice and baseball. And
you know, and as a parent, you just, well, this is with every parent, healthy or unhealthy. You just have to split your time. But yeah, I remember those days, and well, we got a doctor. And sometimes you just have to split the work duties. And one parent goes this way and one that way. But you know, you do it. I mean, and every parent has to do it. And you become very familiar with the medical system.
Right. So, but then there's a lot of other decisions too. As the child ages, what are we going to do? And then also, education.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, and in fact, I remember you and I talking at Metro State University about it, and we talked education. That is an issue with disabilities just in general.
Yeah.
I mean, because you, what you do is you go meet with the school prior to the school year, and you do your IEP, individual education plan.
That's an important thing.
That's an important, extremely important, but, you know, the schools, I mean, I'd rather go to school here than any other country.
That's exactly right.
But still, at the same time, when you go from one grade to the next and you do your IEP the next year, it's almost like they forgot everything from the year before, so you start over. And, you know, and you just...
Or a teacher leaves the profession.
The teacher leaves, or the school nurse who knows you leaves, and, you know, that's... I don't want to say battling, but you have to get everything. You have to, everything from I need to leave class a little early because I can't get to the next room fast.
It sounds like that when we're testifying too. You know, you're always introduced to new politicians and selling what you're going to testify on and testify. But it's that way in education too. Is the point?
Yeah, every year, new teacher, new issue, all the time, and you know what we found over the years is. The younger teachers seem to accept change a little more than the ones that have been around for 30 years, you know. And so we got her through school, you know, and it worked. But every year is an issue as opposed to the my other two children where they just kind of went to school.
And they're doing fine, too.
They're doing great.
So we got a couple minutes left. Is there anything that we might have missed that you want to talk about?
Well, no, I think, you know, one of the things that I think affects maybe everybody with disabilities, not just spina bifida, is getting them out the door. One of the things we're looking at, and we just started this year with the association, is we have what we call a Be Active grant. Mm-hmm. And our goal there is we'll pay 50% of the bill. Let's say we want to get people with spina bifida out the door and get in some sort of community event, or maybe it's a class. And it's interesting, I've seen three or four of them now really just in the last few months where the child with spina bifida has taken martial arts.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah, isn't that something? But it's like a class, you know, and they're taking martial arts. But the goal is get them out the door, you know, because so many people.
Get them active.
Yeah, get them active. That's why it's called the Be Active grant. And so we'll pick up, reimburse 50%. And the whole goal is to get them out. And that's something, I mean, that's not just here in Minnesota, but everywhere. I remember years ago seeing an article from someone in some other state and said, how do we get adults with spina bifida out the door? So I know it's not just us. We just want to get them out there and just be active.
Absolutely.
And that's a goal for next year, is get them out the door.
The other thing with spina bifida is like every other affliction, and is that medical technology is ever changing, so you got to watch for everything.
Well, you know, and sometimes I think for the better, and sometimes I'm not. I have mentioned earlier about you know, they get hydrocephalus and they put a shunt in, and it's really just a tube that goes in, and there's a little pump, and it's back under the skin. You don't see it, and it drains down, and it seems to me that the shunts made 20, 30 years ago work better than the ones today. And so, that, because, you know, you have to get them replaced. I don't know anybody that's had one for a life. You have to get them replaced, you know, and it seems to me the ones that are getting put in now are being replaced earlier. So you're right. You do have to keep watching those things, but it's not always for the better.
No.
It's not.
Well, you know, the way things are made and are customized is different. Anyway, Jim, thank you for your time. Enjoyed having you on the show. Again, Jim Thayer, and you can look his business up on the website. And he's just done a great job for St. Paul, and I want to thank him for being on the show. We'll be right back with more Disability Viewpoints in just a moment. Thanks for watching.
Sweeping changes are coming to assisted living facilities in Minnesota, and they've started as of August 1st this year. Many issues have come about in the assisted living facility and licensure issues, and so today I brought with me Toby Pearson, Vice President of Care Providers Minnesota. So we've got a lot to talk about here today.
Yes, Joan, excited.
Yes.
It should be fun.
Right. Well, because people with disabilities and the seniors live in assisted livings. So what can you tell us about the whole idea of the licensure at assisted living facilities in Minnesota?
Well, it kind of started a couple of years ago. There was a number of press reports and other things that came out talking about the lack of kind of inspections and what was going on in assisted living. And so there are a group of advocates who came forward at the legislature and said, we need to do something. You know, before we moved into licensing assisted living, Minnesota had a housing with services type of model where an individual who was on a waiver would receive the services from a licensed provider. So MDH was licensing the provider to provide the services, but then they got to choose where they wanted to receive those services in a home-like setting, which was then regulated kind of by the landlord-tenant, the local zoning ordinances, all that kind of stuff. I think eventually advocates felt like there was kind of too much division and people weren't able to track all the different things that they were supposed to be getting. And so we started this long conversation about licensing assisted living. We talked about it. It was a long 2-year process of negotiating a whole bunch of things, many of which we got right, some of which probably still need some technical fixes.
Sure.
But
so this started back in 2019.
It started a long time ago, yes.
In
legislative terms, a long time ago.
And
I think it was brought forward in a bipartisan manner. Both the Senate, Senator Housley was kind of the primary person on the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
She's a Republican. Representative Schultz was kind of the primary representative.
Sure.
She's a House Democrat. So there was kind of a bipartisan push to say, we need to get this assisted living licensure. I think the advocates said that, you know, Minnesota was the only state that didn't do assisted living licensure. That was correct in the form of we didn't have one license that provides both services and housing, because I said before we had the housing and the services. The services were licensed, but the housing was not in a licensed capacity.
So what is now the definition of an assisted living in Minnesota?
Well, there is now a bunch of rules and regulations and laws around what you have to do to become an assisted living in Minnesota. We just went through over the summer a whole long process of application. I think the last number I saw was there's somewhere around 2,000 licensed assisted livings in Minnesota.
It's a lot.
It's a lot of facilities, and they range from, you know, very large, several
mm-hmm.
hundred unit facilities, all the way down to 4-10 smaller unit facilities all over the state. So,
it
used to be that if you've seen one assisted living facility, you've seen one assisted living facility.
Mm-hmm.
It's still kind of that way, but now they have similar rules and regulations that they all have to fall under.
Wow. So can you give examples of some of those rules now that they didn't have to follow before that they do now?
Well, there was a couple things on that were kind of interesting in the transition, because it wasn't as much as of new quote-unquote rules as much as making sure that the current rules were kind of updated and also put into one place. So, for example, you would have rules regarding how you could terminate services, but they were all under, you know, one area of law with here's what you have to do if you're going to terminate the services. Advocates brought forward some problems with those, so they said, you know what, we need to make sure that these termination of services include appeal rights, some more kind of integral, like step-by-step processes so that people could see what was going on,
right.
Be a little more transparent. Also things like termination of lease. It was covered by landlord-tenant, but to put it into the kind of a similar place as the termination of services, so if you're an individual, you could then say, okay, let me see the rule on termination and here's the process they have to follow so that I know if things aren't going
right.
well and they're either terminating my housing or my services, this is what has to happen. So I think from that point, there's a certain amount of clarity that was brought into the process. The other thing I would say that both advocates and providers tried to do throughout the negotiations was always keep the individual who was receiving the services first. So looking at it
sure.
through their
that makes
lens,
sense.
Not necessarily that they should get everything they want, but you have to look at it through how are they experiencing it. so that you can come up with how should this work. And it was long, it was arduous, it was a lot of conversations. I think I told you before, you know, we probably got the vast majority of it right.
Mm-hmm.
But we do continue to come back and say, you know what, this technical fix needs to come in here. This probably isn't what we wanted. We probably need to talk about it. The good thing is that both providers, as well as advocates, as well as the Department of Health, have had kind of an open and ongoing conversation about it. We haven't always agreed.
Right.
Once you get those three parties involved, they're not
right.
always going to agree. But trying to come at consensus of, okay, we need to give, you know, MDH needs this, the advocates need that, providers need this, how do we find what's in the middle to make it work for everybody?
Is it just the Minnesota Department of Health that's really guiding this and working towards this full licensure?
Yep, the licensure will be in, or now is in, the mm-hmm. Department of Health. They have a list. They have the process on how you apply for licensure. They will be the overseers as regulators.
Mm-hmm.
Department of Human Services comes in on the payer side. That's a whole different number
right.
of conversations we can have.
That's another whole show.
Yeah, about whether or not Department of Human Services is paying adequately mm-hmm. for services that people with disabilities are receiving
right.
is a whole different right. show. But yeah, on the regulation of the setting side, it's the Department of Health that's in charge of that.
Well, now, certainly Disability Viewpoints, we're very concerned from the disability angle. And what we find out there is that aging and seniors and people with disabilities, their issues really mirror one another. So are you seeing a trend where more people with disabilities are now utilizing the assisted living facilities to live in? Can you say that through your members and your member organizations?
Yeah, at Care Providers, we do have a number of providers now who have been joining recently. So I'd say probably within the last 5 years, we've seen an uptick in the number of folks who are serving individuals with disabilities. And as those we have seen, those people have continued to expand their services to greater numbers. We've definitely seen an increase in folks who are receiving disability services choosing assisted living as their location to receive those services.
Mm-hmm. Were there any organizations, individuals, really not opposing the whole idea of assisted living licensure?
Oh, yes.
What were their issues? Please,
yeah.
Tell.
Well, I do, you know, I think there's a number of folks that you have along a gamut, and you always, in politics, when you're dealing at the legislature, you always have the side that's, you know, absolutely nothing, no regulations, let's keep it free market.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have folks on the other side that are more, we need heavier regulations, we need to make sure. And I think part of the challenge that we had coming together both as providers, kind of MDH as the people who are going to be managing this and enforcing the rules, and advocates, was kind of that point that I made before, which is keeping individuals in the front of it, because
mm-hmm.
if they're in the front of what we're talking about, then we should take a certain balanced perspective as you move forward. There were a number of voices that said, you know, no regulation, no further regulation. And what we found was that a lot of what we were trying to do, because we didn't have a lot of data, we had a lot of anecdotes. And so what we were trying to do is take from those individual experiences mm-hmm. and stories and say, how does that apply then across a broader spectrum? Because a number of folks are going to already be doing kind of best practices.
Mm-hmm.
They will be doing all the stuff that, quote unquote, you should be doing. And so it should really be that there's a number of folks that kind of are already moving along that line. There were also those providers who may not be a member of an association who needed some help and some nudging to kind of move up and across and say,
right.
you need to do a little bit better here. And they needed the stick of, you know, MDH licensure to come in and say, if you don't do better, you can't do it at all and
right.
we won't license you.
Do you foresee some assisted living facilities going away because they're not able to meet the licensure guidelines and rules now?
Well, we're going to actually see an interesting intersection right now because of the pandemic, because you have workforce challenges in both assisted
right.
living and skilled nursing facilities. But in the assisted living side of things, you have the kind of the implementation of this new license with some new more restrictive, more higher requirements, with a lack of ability to hire competent staff. And that's going to cause some challenges and some bumps along the road that folks will just have to figure out how to make sure it works. I would imagine there's going to be some folks that just won't be able to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully that doesn't lead to access problems. But, you know, that's kind of a wait and see that we'll have to kind of see what happens.
Well, as we're ending our time here, if people want to get involved or learn more about this, how would you suggest they go about it?
Well, there's some new stuff at MDH. They're putting out a new, I want to call it a newsletter type of thing. So if you go to the Minnesota Department of Health, there's a newsletter that you can sign up for to mm-hmm. receive kind of their updates on what's going on with assisted living licensure. Obviously, care providers in Minnesota, we have assisted living licensure stuff on our website as well.
What's your website?
Care providers of Minnesota, there it is. Just
okay,
yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So those are two places you can go to look for stuff. You'll have my contact information.
Great.
We can share that. If folks have more questions,
that'd
they can contact
great if you'd
me.
Like to share that.
You can put it up on the screen and folks
okay.
can just give me a call or shoot me an email. Email is probably easiest.
Easiest,
but,
right? And you're busy at the Capitol. Well, fantastic. Well, I can't thank you enough for coming on and talking about this important issue. And we'll have you back another time when we continue to tighten this up and make things just wonderful for everybody living in assisted living.
That'd be great. I look right. forward to it. Thanks for having
yeah.
me, Joan.
Thanks again. Well, we've had another great show. I had Toby Pearson on from Care Providers Minnesota. He was fantastic. Really helped us look at the new assisted living licensure rules. How about you, Mark?
I had Jim Thayer, who is a well-known name in St. Paul and is part of the Spina Bifida Association. And one of the things he talks about is some of the great events coming up next year in 2022. Thanks for watching our show. And Joan, thank you for being here.
Great.
Enjoyed it very much. And we'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints. Bye for now.